Hello, and welcome to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. My name is Mike Parker, and I'm the course instructor. The Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the Restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. The time and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and the handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoyed this lesson, please click the like button and subscribe to this channel to be notified when weekly lessons are posted. And if you find this information useful, please share it with a friend. This is the second of two lessons about the ministry of Jesus Christ among the Book of Mormon peoples. In this lesson, we'll be studying 3 Nephi, chapters 19 through 30. The key individuals in this lesson are the Lord Jesus Christ, the resurrected Son of God, the God of Israel, and the God of the whole earth. Nephi, 3, was the Nephite prophet who kept the sacred records and wrote the history of Jesus' appearance to the people of Nephi. He was called as the first of 11 disciples of the Lord in the New World. The 12 Nephite disciples of Christ are named in 3 Nephi chapter 19, verse 4. Outlining the events that took place in this lesson, on the second and third days of Jesus' visitation, he taught, ministered, prophesied, revealed scripture, and established his church. Jesus later appeared to and taught his 12 Nephite disciples as they journeyed. Three of them were permitted to tarry until he comes again in glory. Mormon concluded the book of 3 Nephi with his commentary on the three Nephite disciples and the coming forth of the Book of Mormon in the last days. This lesson took place in the land Bountiful and the surrounding area, within a few hours walking distance. The text later mentions the journeying of the 12 Nephite disciples, but it does not say where they traveled to or from. The events covered in this lesson took place at the end of the 34th year since the signs of the birth of Christ appeared, circa AD 30. In the last lesson, we discussed the great calamities that occurred in the Book of Mormon lands at the time of Christ's crucifixion. Almost 1 year later, the resurrected Jesus Christ appeared to the people of Nephi in the land Bountiful, where he taught, healed, and ministered, and administered the sacrament to them. On the second and third days of Jesus' visit, he taught, ministered, prophesied, revealed, and interpreted scripture, and established his church. Jesus' teachings on the first day had focused on the law. His teachings on the second day will be about the prophets. After Jesus had ascended into heaven at the end of the first day of his ministry, the people of Nephi returned to their homes. News of Jesus' visit spread throughout the area around Bountiful, and an exceedingly great number of people gathered to the temple to see him when he returned the next day. The 12 Nephite disciples ministered to the people who had gathered. These 12 men were mentioned previously, but in chapter 19, we learn their names. They were Nephi, the third, Timothy, the brother of Nephi. 3 years ago, wicked Nephites had stoned him to death, but Nephi raised him from the dead. Jonas, the first, son of Nephi. Mathoni, Mathonihah, brother of Mathoni. Cumen, Cumenohi, Jeremiah, Shemnon, Jonas the second, he was different than the other Jonas above, Zedekiah, and Isaiah. Other than Nephi and Timothy, we know nothing about the backgrounds and accomplishments of these men. Throughout the Book of Mormon, these 12 are always referred to as disciples, never as apostles. In a vision given to Nephi the First, an angel told him that these 12 disciples would be chosen to minister to Nephi the First's descendants and to be their judges. The angel also said that these disciples were subordinate to the 12 apostles in Jerusalem. Despite not being called as apostles, Jesus gave his 12 Nephite disciples authority comparable to that held by the 12 apostles in Jerusalem. The multitude of people that had gathered to the temple was so numerous that the disciples divided the people into 12 groups so they could teach and minister to them. The disciples then prayed to the Father in the name of Jesus that the Holy Ghost should be given unto them. After this, the 12 disciples all submitted to baptism, beginning with Nephi. After this, they were filled with the Holy Ghost and with fire, were encircled about as if it were by fire, and angels ministered to them. At least some of these men, including Nephi, had certainly been baptized before Jesus appeared in the Americas. These cases would have been examples of the practice of rebaptism, in which individuals who had been baptized previously were baptized again as a symbol of their renewed commitment to God's covenants, or because Jesus had established his church anew among them. While this Pentecostal experience was taking place, Jesus came and stood in the midst of the multitude. He commanded all who were present to kneel, and he directed his disciples to pray. The 12 did pray unto Jesus, calling him their Lord and their God. Three times Jesus himself went a little way off and offered his own prayers to the Father. The final time, he used words so great and marvelous that they cannot be written, neither can they be uttered by man. He told his disciples that he had never seen such great faith among all the Jews. Hence, the Nephite people had seen and heard greater things than any of those in Galilee or Judea. He then told the multitude to cease praying, but that they should not cease to pray in their hearts. Jesus' first two prayers to the Father were similar to his great intercessory prayer at the Last Supper, recorded in John chapter 17, in which he prayed for unity between himself and his Father, unity between the Father, the Son, and the apostles, and unity with all those who would believe in the apostles' testimony. The disciples prayed to Jesus rather than to the Father, and they were told by revelation what they should pray. Jesus permitted them to pray to him because I am with them. Otherwise, the commandment he gave the people, which they followed except in this one instance, was the pattern Jesus himself established in the Lord's Prayer, pray to the Father in Jesus' name. Jesus blessed the 12 disciples as they prayed, and they were transfigured. Their countenances became as white and brilliant as his own. Jesus administered the sacrament again, this time miraculously providing the bread and wine. He promised those who partook that their souls shall never hunger nor thirst, but shall be filled, and they were filled with the Spirit. The fact that he offered the sacrament to the people of Nephi on both days underscores to me the importance of this ordinance to the Lord's covenant people. Jesus then prophesied of the future of this people who are a remnant of the house of Israel. Woven into his prophecies are quotations and interpretations of the writings of the Old Testament prophets Micah, Moses, Abraham, and Isaiah. He declared that the words of Isaiah would be fulfilled. The scattered remnants of Israel will be gathered and brought to the knowledge of the Lord their God. Quoting the prophecies of Micah, he declared that if the Gentiles do not repent after they are given the gospel, the Lord's judgment will fall upon them, and Israel will destroy them. Quoting a prophecy of Moses, Jesus said he would establish Lehi's descendants in the promised land of the Americas. He is Jehovah, the God who covenanted with Lehi's ancestor, Jacob. He is the prophet Moses spoke of, and of whom all the prophets since Samuel have testified. Quoting from a revelation to Abraham, he declared that the descendants of Lehi are the children of the prophets and part of the covenant people of Israel, through whom all the kindreds of the earth shall be blessed. Jesus came to the people of Nephi first to restore the truth because they were the covenant people. After them, the Gentiles would receive the gospel. The Gentiles would scatter the people of Israel, but if the Gentiles hardened their hearts against him, Jesus would remember his covenant and restore Israel to the lands of their inheritance and send the gospel to them. And they shall believe in me that I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Quoting from a prophecy of Isaiah, Jesus then returned to the text of Isaiah chapter 52, a portion of which he had quoted the previous day. The Father's power will purify and restore Israel, and this will be accomplished through his Son, the suffering servant. Jesus revised Isaiah's text, replacing the Lord, that is to say Jehovah, in Isaiah 52, verses 9 and 10, with the Father in 3 Nephi chapter 20, verses 34 and 35, and adding the phrase, "And the Father and I are one." Like Nephi the first and other prophets, Jesus had intentionally modified Isaiah's text to suit the purposes of his message. Jesus then revealed a sign that ye may know the time when these things shall be about to take place, meaning the gathering of Israel and the establishment of Zion. When Jesus' words in the Book of Mormon would come forth unto the Gentiles, who would be established in the land by the Father as a free people, it shall be a sign unto the descendants of Lehi, that they may know that the work of the Father hath already commenced unto the fulfilling of the covenant which he hath made unto the people who are of the house of Israel. We today are living during the time when the Father is fulfilling the covenant he made with Israel. Continuing his use of the same prophecy of Isaiah, Jesus taught that this work of the Father, the coming forth of the Book of Mormon, shall be a great and marvelous work that will be so astonishing that many, including kings, will not believe it. Quote, "The life of my servant," that is to say Joseph Smith, "shall be in my hand. Therefore they," the Gentiles who reject the Book of Mormon, "shall not hurt him, although he shall be marred," that is to say disfigured, "because of them." Unquote. 3 Nephi 21 verse 10 is a quotation of Isaiah 52 verse 14, and it's quite interesting. In Isaiah's original context, it's a prophecy of the suffering servant, God's Messiah or Christ, who will be rejected and abused by his own people. Here, Jesus adapted this passage to apply it to the prophet Joseph Smith, through whom the Book of Mormon would be revealed in that last day. This is the earliest prophecy that Joseph Smith would be marred, that is to say, injured, killed. Jesus next quoted from a prophecy of Micah. Micah was a contemporary of Isaiah, and his prophecy was originally a warning given to Israel. In his sermon to the Nephites, Jesus gave Micah's prophecy a new context as a warning to the Gentiles who would reject his gospel in the last days. "Whosoever will not repent and come unto my beloved Son, them will I cut off from among my people." Returning again to the prophecy of Isaiah, Jesus promised that if the Gentiles would repent and believe the Book of Mormon, the Lord would establish my church among them and make them part of his covenant people. They would help build the city of New Jerusalem and assist in gathering Israel to the lands of their inheritance. Jesus then quoted the entirety of Isaiah chapter 54, which was a prophecy of the gathering of Israel to Zion in peace and safety. Isaiah's message was one of reassurance to Israel that the Lord's anger against them had subsided and that the Lord had promised that Israel would be restored. Jesus concluded his lengthy quotation of Isaiah's writings by commanding the people to search these things diligently, for great are the words of Isaiah concerning both Israel and the Gentiles. He promised, "Whosoever will hearken unto my words, and repenteth, and is baptized, the same shall be saved. Search the prophets, for many there be that testify of these things." After Jesus had expounded all the scriptures unto them which they had received, he said unto them, "Behold, other scriptures I would that ye should write, that ye have not." Jesus commanded Nephi to write an account of the resurrection of many righteous people that took place after Jesus had been resurrected. This event had been prophesied by Samuel the Lamanite prophet, but the account of its fulfillment had not been written in Nephi's record. Jesus then revealed and caused to be written the prophecies of Malachi, whose ministry took place over 100 years after Lehi left Jerusalem. Malachi chapters 3 and 4 have to do with events leading up to the Lord's second coming and how to be spared when the Lord comes in glory. Jesus next expounded to the multitude all things, both great and small, even from the beginning until the time that he should come in his glory, when all people will be resurrected and judged by God. Mormon then added his own commentary. He could not write even a hundredth part of the things which Jesus did truly teach unto the people. The Gentiles in the last days would give Mormon's account, the Book of Mormon, to the descendants of Lehi. And if it shall so be that they, the Lamanites, shall believe these things, then shall the greater things be made manifest unto them. A full account of Jesus' teachings was written on the plates of Nephi, but the Lord commanded Mormon to not copy all of it into his record, because the Lord declared, "I will try the faith of my people." At the conclusion of the second day of his ministry among the people of Nephi, Jesus taught and ministered to the children, who spoke great and marvelous things, healed all their sick and disabled, and raised a man from the dead. He then ascended into heaven again. Mormon's account of the third day of Jesus' ministry is short, only 112 words in three verses. The events of this day were apparently so sacred that he would only write a brief overview of what had happened. "Children did open their mouths and utter marvelous things, and the things which they did utter were forbidden that there should not any man write them." Jesus' disciples began to baptize and continued doing so from that time forth. Many of the people saw and heard unspeakable things which are not lawful to be written. After his three-day ministry, Jesus did show himself unto them oft and administer the sacrament. The people of the Church of Christ lived the law of consecration and the other commandments Jesus gave them. Sometime later, the 12 Nephite disciples were united in mighty prayer and fasting as they traveled to preach and baptize. Jesus came and stood in the midst of them and asked them what they wanted. The disciples explained that there was some disagreement among believers as to what name they should give Christ's church. Jesus reminded them of the scriptures, which say, "Ye must take upon you the name of Christ, which is my name. Therefore, ye shall call the church in my name, since it is his church and is built on his gospel." When Jesus first appeared at the temple in Bountiful, he had defined his doctrine as faith, repentance, baptism, and receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. He now defined his gospel. Note the textual bookends in this passage. "This is the gospel which I have given unto you," in verse 13, and "This is my gospel," in verse 21. 3 Nephi 27, verses 13 through 22, quote, "Behold, I have given unto you my gospel, and this is the gospel which I have given unto you, that I came into the world to do the will of my Father, because my Father sent me. And my Father sent me that I might be lifted up upon the cross. And after that I had been lifted up upon the cross, that I might draw all men unto me, that as I have been lifted up by men, even so should men be lifted up by the Father, to stand before me, to be judged of their works, whether they be good or whether they be evil. And for this cause have I been lifted up. Therefore, according to the power of the Father, I will draw all men unto me, that they may be judged according to their works. And it shall come to pass, that whoso repenteth and is baptized in my name shall be filled. And if he endureth to the end, behold, him will I hold guiltless before my Father at that day when I shall stand to judge the world. And he that endureth not unto the end, the same is he that is also hewn down and cast into the fire, from whence they can no more return, because of the justice of the Father. And this is the word which he hath given unto the children of men. And for this cause he fulfilleth the words which he hath given, and he lieth not, but fulfilleth all his words. And no unclean thing can enter into his kingdom. Therefore nothing entereth into his rest, save it be those who have washed their garments in my blood, because of their faith, and the repentance of all their sins, and their faithfulness unto the end. Now this is the commandment. Repent, all ye ends of the earth, and come unto me, and be baptized in my name, that ye may be sanctified by the reception of the Holy Ghost, that ye may stand spotless before me at the last day. Verily, verily, I say unto you, this is my gospel. And ye know the things that ye must do in my church. For the works which ye have seen me do, that shall ye also do. For that which ye have seen me do, even that shall ye do. Therefore, if ye do these things, blessed are ye, for ye shall be lifted up at the last day. Unquote. Jesus defined the gospel as the following 8 points of doctrine. 1. Jesus came into the world to do the Father's will. 2. The Father sent Jesus to be crucified. 3. Because of his atonement, Jesus will judge all men according to their works. 4. Those who repent and are baptized shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. 5. If they continue in faith by enduring to the end, they will be held guiltless, that is to say, justified, by Jesus before the Father. 6. If they don't endure to the end, they will be subject to the justice of God and cast out of his presence. 7. The Father's words will all be fulfilled. 8. Because no unclean thing can enter the Father's heavenly kingdom, only those who rely in faith on the atonement of Christ, repent, and are faithful to the end, can be saved. In January 1831, the Lord revealed something similar through the prophet Joseph Smith in Doctrine and Covenants 39, verses 5 and 6. Quote, "And verily, verily, I say unto you, he that receiveth my gospel receiveth me, and he that receiveth not my gospel receiveth not me. And this is my gospel, repentance and baptism by water, and then cometh the baptism of fire and the Holy Ghost, even the Comforter, which showeth all things and teacheth the peaceable things of the kingdom." Unquote. The revelations to Joseph Smith declare that the Book of Mormon contains the fullness of the gospel, meaning it contains the good news that Jesus Christ has atoned for our sins and prepared the way for us to dwell with him and his Father in the kingdom of God. The Book of Mormon does not contain some important doctrines, like the degrees of glory in God's heavenly kingdom and eternal marriage, but those things, while part of God's plan of salvation, are beyond the narrow definition of the gospel that Jesus gave his disciples. Jesus commanded his 12 disciples to write what they had seen and heard, including the works of this people, for the people would be judged by what the disciples wrote, and these things will become part of the Father's book of life. The Nephite disciples shall be judges of this people. Therefore, he counseled them, what manner of men ought ye to be? Verily I say unto you, even as I am. Whatever they would ask the Father in Jesus' name would be given to them. Jesus and his Father both took great joy in that generation of Nephites, but Jesus prophesied that the fourth generation from that time would turn from the gospel. He commanded his disciples, enter ye in at the straight gate. Jesus then asked his disciples, what is it that ye desire of me, after that I am gone unto the Father? Nine of his disciples wished to complete their mortal ministries, and then speedily come unto thee in thy kingdom. Jesus blessed them for this desire, and granted each of them a lifespan of 72 years. The three remaining disciples were hesitant to say what it was they desired, but Jesus knew their thoughts. They wanted to be transfigured so they could remain on the earth to preach the gospel until Jesus came again in glory. Jesus granted their desire, telling them that they were more blessed because of this, and that they would not experience death, nor pain, nor sorrow, except for sorrow for the sins of the world. He told them that they would be changed in the twinkling of an eye from mortality to immortality at the second coming, and sit down in the kingdom of my Father and be even as I am. Jesus touched the nine and departed. The three disciples who were to tarry were transfigured and caught up into heaven, where they saw and heard unspeakable things. The 12 Nephite disciples continued to minister in great power. Prisons and pits could not hold them. Furnaces and wild beasts could not harm them. Many people of that generation were converted, baptized, and united with the Church of Christ. The Lord commanded Mormon to not write the names of the three Nephite disciples, but he testified, I have seen them, and they have ministered unto me. They would minister among the Gentiles, the Jews, and the scattered tribes of Israel, bringing many souls unto Christ and performing great and marvelous works. The Lord revealed to Mormon that their bodies underwent a physical and spiritual change so they could live and remain on earth. This was not a resurrection, that is a greater transformation and will take place at the judgment day, but a change so that they would not suffer pain and so Satan could have no power over them. Mormon affirmed that the Book of Mormon would go forth to the Gentiles in the last days, as Jesus foretold. He pronounced woes upon those who will deny Christ, revelations, prophecy, spiritual gifts, and miracles, and upon those who abuse the Jews, the Lord's covenant people. He commanded the Gentiles to turn from your wicked ways and repent of your evil doings and be baptized and numbered with my people who are of the house of Israel. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes and this slideshow. Next week, we'll review and discuss Mormon's record of the decline and fall of the Nephite people during the three centuries after Christ's visitation. The reading for the upcoming lesson is 4 Nephi and Mormon chapters 1 through 7. See you then.